Begin today.
Amen. It didn't take a whole lot of thinking there to get through that. Praise God. You know, the Lord has been blessing so much through our study of 1 John, and I want to encourage you to read this little letter. It's only 5 short chapters. Read it often. Think about what the Lord is saying. Think about the words that John uses in this, in the text of this letter to encourage and to strengthen and to build up and to develop the people of God. You know, as we begin this morning, the title of the message is His Sacrifice and Our Obedience. I want you to begin this morning by thinking about the words of Jesus that John recorded back in his gospel. Chapter 14, verse 23 and 24. He said, if anyone, that anyone is all of us here, listen, if anyone loves me, he will keep my word. He will be obedient to my word. He said, my Father will love him, and we will come to him and we will make our home with him, showing the triune nature of God there. The one who doesn't love me will not keep my words. The word that you hear is not mine, but it's from the Father who sent me. Very important that you continue to think about that verse as we move over to John's letter this morning. We're moving into chapter 2 today, and as we continue to think about that passage, I want you to consider how it ties into the text of our message today. We're going to discover very quickly that John is going to carry us deeper into the doctrinal truths, the truths concerning sin, the truths concerning the Savior's sacrifice for our sin, and the requirement for our obedience to the Lord's commands. You're going to find a great many similarities that exist between what we studied in chapter 1 and what we will now begin to study in chapter 2. If you have failed to be here during the time that we've gone through chapter 1, you can access the videos of the messages. We've got them on YouTube, or we put them on Facebook onto our site there, and you can access those. If you don't know how to get to them, you can ask me, and I'll tell you how to get to them. And you can begin to look at these things. There should be 3 sermons in chapter 1, and this is our 4th sermon in this series as we look into chapter 2 now. I want to begin by looking back at 1 John chapter 1, verse 7, and I want you to think about what he writes here. He says, but if we walk in the light, as he himself is in the light, we have fellowship with one another, and the blood of Jesus, his son, cleanses us from how much of our sin?
All of our sin.
The blood of Jesus doesn't pick and choose which part of our sins are forgiven, but the blood of Jesus cleanses you and I from all of our sin. You know, this verse, it draws a direct correlation between walking in the light and the blood of Jesus, his son, cleansing us from all sin. It is vital for you and I to grasp the truth that you cannot walk in the light and continue walking in a life of habitual sin. You can't do those 2 things at the same time, because the Bible clearly teaches us that they are total opposites of each other. So you choose to either walk in the light or you choose to walk in the flesh and in the sinful nature of the flesh, but you can't do them both. So if you want to be drawing into an intimate relationship with the Father and be walking in His light, it means that you are going to be putting away the sinful nature. You are going to be taking that sinful nature that is within all of us, and you are going to be allowing the spiritual nature that came upon you, that filled you when you surrendered to Jesus, you are going to allow that spiritual nature nature to begin to become dominant in your life. If you've been missing our Sunday school classes, we've been talking through the book of Romans, and it's a very exciting, very intense study, but it talks about these things, and just in probably another month and a half, we're going to get into that area where Paul begins talking about his struggle that goes on inside of him between the flesh man and the spirit man. And, this is going on in all of us. Constantly, there is this flesh man that's wanting to come out. He's wanting to have authority. He's wanting to speak his mind and act out his will in and through your life. But on the opposite side is the spirit man that has come into you and filled you, that is trying to gain authority, trying to gain prominence in your life. But you as an individual have to determine, am I going to listen to the spirit man, or am I going to listen to the flesh man? Who am I going to listen to? Who am I going to become obedient to? Because you can't do them both. You determine what you're going to do. As humans struggling daily against the desires of the fleshly sinful nature, you and I are going to falter and we're going to sin. As long as we're stuck in this human body, we will sin. The blood of Jesus Christ cleanses us from all sin, continues cleansing us. But as we mature in our Christian walk, you and I should find ourselves progressively moving away from the sinful nature, gravitating toward the spiritual nature. As a believer, listen to me, your conduct and your inactions should indicate that you are progressively walking more and more in God's light. John indicates that Christians, they do sin daily, but then he goes on to point out that God's remedy for our sin is Jesus Christ. And he further encourages believers to practice obedience to God and his word. The more we plant the word of God into our hearts, the less we will sin against God. David said, I have planted your word in my heart that I might not sin against you. He understood that the more this word became a part of his life, the less sin was going to have a part of his life. Because the word washes us, the word cleanses us, the word purifies us. And so, as we plant this word into our life, we become less and less listeners or hearers of the flesh, and more walkers in the spirit.
Amen.
The believer who desires to follow Jesus Christ's commands to continue growing more Christ-like must learn the necessity of going daily before the advocate. We're going to talk about that. John's going to talk about the advocate, who is Jesus Christ. He is our mediator. Because it is Jesus who grants cleansing from all sin through the work of his sacrifice on the cross. It is Jesus who stands in the gap for you and I. We approach the Father through the Son. Not through some father here on earth, or through Mary, or through some saint. We go to the Father through the Son. Through the shed blood of Jesus Christ, we are allowed access into the Holy of Holies. It's Jesus who grants that cleansing. And those who choose to walk this life, or who choose to live this life, are going to learn to live according to God's word. If you want to live the Spirit-filled life, you will live according to God's word. You will be walking in Christ's likeness. Now, I want us to look at 1 John chapter 2, the first 6 verses today. We're going to tear these verses apart, if you will, to better understand what God is telling us. But these verses say this, beginning with verse 1. John says, my little children, I am writing you these things so that you may not sin. But if anyone does sin, we have an advocate with the Father, Jesus Christ, the righteous one. He himself is the propitiation. Now, in Sunday school, we've gone through this word propitiation, so we have a better understanding, and I'll explain it a little further here in a few moments. He himself is the propitiation for our sins, and not only for ours, but also for those of the whole world. This is how we are sure that we have come to know him, by keeping his commands. The one who says, "I have come to know him," without keeping his commands is what? A liar. And he says that the truth is not in him. But whoever keeps his word, truly in him the love of God is perfected, made perfect, made pure, made holy. This is how we know we are in him. The one who says he remains in him should walk just as he walked. That the introduction that I gave you is pretty much a summary of what those verses say. Kind of opens the door, if you will, to understanding these verses. So I want us to look at this and help, if we can, to clarify what the Lord is trying to tell us today. And we begin by understanding the foundational truths that pertain to this. And number one is our Savior's sacrifice for our sins. Verse 1 and 2, going back very quickly, he says, "My little children, I'm writing you these things so that you may not sin. But if anyone does sin, we have an advocate with the Father, Jesus Christ, the righteous one. He himself is the propitiation for our sins, and not only for ours, but for those of the entire world." John's opening phrase is, "My little children." John is very elderly at this time. And this is kind of an endearment, if you will. He's trying to draw into a direct relationship through Jesus Christ with you and I. And he's speaking as a teacher unto his students. He's saying, "My little children, listen to what I've got to say. I love you. I care about you. I want you to understand these things because I want you to live in these things. I want you to walk in these things. I want these things to be a part of your everyday life." The same way that a parent would lovingly speak to their children, that's what John is doing to you and I. You don't touch that stove because it will hurt you. It will burn you. You tell the child that because you love them. If you didn't care about them, you couldn't care them. You know, go ahead, do what you want to. But because you love them, you warn them. You put up red flags. You say, "Be careful, beware, watch out." And that's what John is telling us here. He's speaking as a father to the children. Watch out, listen up, heed what I've got to say. This is so very important today. See, out of this love, John faces the problem of sin head on. By proclaiming that the only means of intervention into the destructive power of sin is through Jesus Christ. There is no other way. There is no other means. The world is constantly throwing up all these different ways. They say that Christianity is kind of exceptionalism, don't you think? You know, how can you go saying that your Jesus is the only way? You know, that's kind of prideful of you. That's kind of boastful of you. I'm not saying it. Jesus said it. And Jesus proved it. He took it to the punch, if you will, when he was resurrected from the dead. You know, Buddha could have said, "I am the way." Problem with Buddha is his bones are still on the ground. All these others could have said, "I'm the way." And yet, you can go to their burial site and they're still there. But Jesus Christ came up from the grave. He put the stamp of God's approval upon everything he had done by being resurrected and being alive and living for you and I. Proving to be the Son of the living God. Hebrews 7, verse 25 through 27 confirms this by telling us these words. He says, "He, Jesus, is always able to save those who come to God through him, since he always lives to intercede for them." Now, the writer of Hebrews, he understood that Jesus is alive. He probably saw Jesus alive. He probably witnessed Jesus speaking, being in the flesh, eating, being there, following his resurrection from the dead. And therefore, he understood this as a fact. He always lives interceding for them. For this is the kind of high priest we need. Holy, innocent, undefiled, separated from sinners, and exalted above the heavens. He doesn't need to offer sacrifices every day as the high priests do, first for their own sins and then for those of the people. Jesus did this once for all when he offered up himself. In other words, what the writer to the Hebrews is saying is Christ bore the penalty of our sin when he died for you and I on the cross. And then he arose from the dead, and now he is standing in the gap for you and I, interceding before the throne of God. He is like one of these real high power attorneys who knows what they're doing. And I hate to, I don't mean to bring any kind of negativity to the name of Jesus, but it's something we can kind of understand. These attorneys that they're really good at what they do. You know, if you really want to get off, you know, that you go to this guy and you pay an astronomical fee, he's going to get you off. Jesus Christ is our mediator. He's our intercessor. He is our attorney, if you will. So when we come before the throne of God with sin in our life, the blood of Jesus washes us, and Jesus, the righteous one, covers us in his robe of righteousness, so we are able to stand before the Father holy and pure. He doesn't see our sinfulness. He doesn't see our sinful ways and our unholy ways, because Jesus becomes our righteousness. He stands in the gap on our behalf, and his righteousness is imputed to us. We are clothed in his righteousness. It's nothing I did, but all that he has done for me. So when we have surrendered our lives to Jesus Christ, his righteousness clothes us, and we become the righteousness of God through our Lord Jesus Christ. Just because the blood of Jesus restores the repentant to fellowship doesn't make sin any less serious. And I want us to understand this. To protect us from underestimating the impact of our sin, John tells us here in verse 1 that Jesus must come to our defense as our advocate when we sin. Remember, he said, when you do sin. So you and I are going to sin. We need to understand that. We talked about that back in chapter 1, that we are all sinners saved by grace.
Amen.
But we will continue to sin. We will continue to falter. We will continue to fail the Lord by allowing things to come into our life and by allowing ourselves to do things and be things that we shouldn't be. But like John is saying, we should progressively be moving more and more away from that as we're moving more and more towards Christ and towards being Christ-like. But we know that we have an advocate who has already paid the price. An advocate who is capable of standing in the gap for us, whose blood has already cleansed us. The guilt of our failures when we do sin can weigh heavy on our hearts. And so John uses these words to reassure us of our protection that comes through trusting in Jesus Christ.
Amen.
And as a child of God, you will try not to sin. Power of sin was broken at the cross, but you will falter. You will slip up, but you can rest assured in the redeeming power of the blood of Jesus Christ to cleanse you and to bring you back into right fellowship with the Father.
Amen.
Verse 2 emphasizes that the sacrifice that was made by Jesus on the cross appeased the wrath of God against the sin of all humanity. Now we need to understand this word propitiation, because it's not used very much in our vocabulary today. They understood it very well back in the Bible days, because in the Greek world there was and the Roman world that was so prevalent at that time, they had a plethora of gods. They had a god for everything, for every problem, for every situation. They had innumerable gods for all things. Well, these gods weren't like the Heavenly Father who paid the price for us. Rather, you had to do things. You had to do works in order to appease their wrath. In order to come before them, you had to provide something that you produced, whether it was a work or a product or whatever the requirement was. And so this word propitiation is that price of appeasement of an angry God. And so Jesus became our propitiation. You say, well, God's not an angry God. God is angry against sin. God's anger is against sin. Thus, God's wrath is against sin. God's wrath was poured out upon Jesus Christ when on the cross he cried out, my God, why have you forsaken me? He was feeling the wrath of God being poured out upon himself. He was feeling your sin and my sin and the sins of all humanity being poured out upon him. And as that happened, he lost fellowship with the Father. And never in all eternity past had Jesus experienced being out of fellowship with the Father. And at that moment, as he hung on the cross and our sins were poured upon him, he discovered something he had never felt before. And it was at that moment that he yelled out those words, my God, why have you forsaken me? It was at that moment that he felt that separation that he had never experienced before. You and I are born into this world separated from God. Our sin nature separates us from God. But Jesus Christ, through his shed blood, brings us into a right relationship with the Father. Amen. When we accept that, the wrath of God, our wrath, was taken by Jesus Christ. But the Bible tells us there's a time coming. There's a time coming when all humanity who have refused the blood sacrifice of Jesus Christ, who have refused to surrender their lives to Jesus, will feel the impending wrath of God upon their sin as they stand before the great white throne judgment of our Lord Jesus Christ. And he reveals to them how they had an opportunity, how they were given an opportunity, and then the real wrath is felt as he says, cursed, I never knew you. And he throws them forever into the pit of hell. That alone should drive you and I to witness to people. That alone, the thought of sinful man being cast into an eternal hell should coerce, should drive, should motivate you and I to get up and to share the good news of Jesus Christ. To be careful that our actions always reveal Jesus Christ.
Amen, 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 amen.
Man is guilty before God, and his sin separates him from God. But as our advocate, Jesus doesn't have to manipulate the evidence for you and I. He doesn't have to make excuses for our sin, because his entire case was based upon the fact that he himself paid the price. Innocent blood for our sins. He did for you.